Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining us in our fourth and final installment in our carbon fiber webinar series. Today we are joined by John Calhoun from Nexa3D. John, you want to take a quick minute to introduce yourself?
Sure. Thanks, Greg. I'm the business development manager for Nexa3D, which offers QLS selective laser sintering products. We also offer high-speed resin printing products and also injection moldable resin materials as well.
Excellent. So before we get started into the material overview, I'd like to give a little background about who we are, Cimquest. Been a manufacturing partner to many companies on the Eastern Seaboard for upwards of 30 years. Next slide, please. Excellent. Thank you. A little about who we are. We've been serving the Mid-Atlantic and Northeast for 33 years, since 1990, covering from North Carolina North, Ohio East, up into Maine. We're at about 60 employees of varying responsibilities. Next slide, please. Excellent. We specialize in three primary areas, starting with Mastercam. We are one of the world's largest Mastercam resellers, both when it comes to support and training. I'll get a little bit more in depth in that in a minute. We also provide scanning for reverse engineering and metrological installations. And we also provide 3D printing both as a service and selling the solutions themselves, including the Nexa technology that we're going to talk about today. Next slide, please. So just a quick overview of all of the different arms of where Cimquest brings value. And we provide this for all of the solutions that we represent, both all when it comes to support. So phone support, email support, on-site support, customization, specifically when it comes to like Mastercam, post-processor development and customization, as well as engineering and CAD modeling services. We are a consultancy for 3D printer selection, 3D scanning, and as I mentioned before, engineering and CAD modeling. We have a number of different training facilities, both providing for in-person training as well as remote training for our 3D printing offering, 3D scanning offering, as well as Mastercam, as well as implementation services, and as I mentioned before, 3D printing services as well. Next slide, please. Just a brief overview of all of the 3D printing technology that Cimquest represents. We specialize in both polymers and metals. On the polymer side of things, we have digital light projection, SLA, and SLA as far as our VAT polymerization solutions are considered. We offer a few different FFF solutions, including MakerBot, UltiMaker, and 3D Gents. As far as powder bed fusion is concerned, we also provide multi-jet fusion and selective laser sintering. For metal, we also we provide FFF for metal, metal binder jetting, liquid metal deposition, as well as direct metal laser sintering. Next slide. This is the fourth and final installment of this series, talking about specifically carbon fiber, but you know, as an overview, filler materials inside of polymers. Next slide. So the question that we talk about initially is why reinforce? And the reason why is most traditional 3D printing materials such as nylons or in terms of FDM, ABS, and PLAs, is they're convenient for printing because they melt, and in the case of FDM, they extrude easily. However, this fact means that they can also sometimes lack certain material properties needed for certain engineering applications. This led to material manufacturers to say, hey, what can we do here to reinforce these materials, give them better properties easily? So at the end of the day, when you fill a material, it needs to do a couple things. First off, it needs to enhance the base material properties of the native material. But it also needs to be able to print easily, and it also needs appropriate dispersibility. You don't want uneven dispersion of a filler material so that you get some areas stronger in one part and some areas weaker in a part because you don't have successful dispersion. So they need to be able to print, they need to be able to add additional material properties, and they need to be able to be the filler needs to be able to be dispersed. So it's commonly accepted that carbon fiber is one of the best filler materials because of its ability to both increase the performance while also being able to be printed successfully, both when it comes to FDM and SLS. So you get that reinforcement while also being able to print successful parts. So what exactly does it do? If you think of the base polymer, can you go back, John? Yep, if you think of the base polymer like concrete, right? You can think of a filler kind of like rebar or crushed stone. What it's doing is it's providing structure inside the base material that interlocks with itself. This picture of concrete's a good example. It creates structure so that it enhances the properties of the base material. So what is it doing? It's providing stronger parts because what that's gonna do is stronger impact resistance. When you drop something or when you impact something, that rigidity is inside the filler, the base material is going to provide additional reinforcement. So you get better stiffness and impact resistance and better overall better performing parts. Now, another thing that this does is when you're dealing in a situation where polymers get either extruded or melted, it helps against warpage reduction as a part gets printed or cools, because that additional rigidity is going to, again, act as that rebar and hold that structure as the part cools. So you're gonna get that better, that stronger part in the end, but you're also gonna get, what I'll say is easier printability because of that warpage reduction. So on thin-walled parts, things like that, it's gonna provide you that additional rigidity that you won't have to worry about warpage as much. Next slide, please. Now, additionally, what it's going to do is it's going to add to chemical resistance. Now, in the cases of when we talked about Formlabs or in the cases of the Nexa material, the predominant material that's being added to is nylon. This is a material that already has extraordinarily high chemical resistance properties. So it might not be something that adds in that area, but when you add it to an FDM material such as PLA or ABS, it's definitely going to enhance that chemical resistance. It's also going to provide a higher heat deflection temperature. Like when we think about, again, that concrete with the rebar, as the heat deflection temperature is measured by two factors, pressure and heat. So if I apply 66 PSI at varying temperatures, at what temperature is that part going to start to show deflection? Because we're not talking about glass transition temperature, or we're not talking about melting point. We're talking about at what point do we start to see any little bit of deflection under pressure at a certain temperature. So there are a number of different industry standards that are used to meet requirements that different applications have. But again, it's providing that additional rigidity by interlocking those chopped carbon fibers to add that additional rigidity and impact resistance. Additionally, what you're going to find is electrostatic dissipative qualities. Now, in most instances, additive manufacturing companies achieve ESD properties through what are called carbon nanotubes. Now, that might not be the base goal of adding a chopped carbon fiber to a material, but when you add carbon to this material, you're inherently going to provide the presence of carbon nanotubes, giving some level of electrostatic dissipation. Now, usually you're trying to achieve a certain level. So while it might not necessarily get to the level that you're trying to achieve, it will give you some level of dissipation. What they do is these nanotubes provide a passageway for the electricity to travel through, thus allowing it to dissipate before it reaches the end of the parts. Integrating carbon fiber into the material, again, injects these nanotubes into the base material, providing more electrostatic dissipative qualities. Next slide, please. So where does this fit? In a number of different instances, first and foremost, I would say functional prototypes. What this can do is if you have an engineering grade application that requires high chemical resistance or high heat deflection temperature or high tensile strength, and you don't want to cut a mold yet, while you might not necessarily make the production part out of the material, it gives you enhanced qualities to be able to test the geometric nature of your part to make sure it's going to perform in the nature that you want in an enhanced environment against these, you know, impacts or heat or chemical resistance to get an idea of how the part's going to perform from a baseline level. Replacing some metal parts such as jigs, fixtures, tooling. Oftentimes these parts are made in one of two ways. So either they're insourced, which means that they're made in-house, and then you have you have one person or a group of people that are dedicated to making these jigs, fixtures, or tools. So what if you could automate the manufacture of these manufacturing aids and reallocate those resources to more operationally valuable positions? So that's what being able to automate the generation of these jigs and fixtures in this carbon fiber material, you're not going to sacrifice much on strength, but you'll be able to automate. Or if you outsource these parts, usually what you'll find is there is an extensive lead time. Most job shops have extensive lead times and additional costs of having somebody else make these parts. So being able to recreate the strength that you're looking for in these manufacturing jigs, fixtures, and tools, you're going to be able to insource them while automating the process. And then just general parts that require high impact resistance and rigidity. So anything that you're going to have that's going to need to be able to be stronger than the base material while being able to be generated quickly and effectively and repeatedly. So what I'll do now is I'll turn it over to John, and John can talk a bit about the Nexa solution and the materials that are available on the QLS. John?
Thanks, Greg. Appreciate that. So let's talk about the materials we offer currently for all of our QLS platforms that are reinforced. First up is a PA6 mineral filled reinforcement. It's a very stiff material with a very high heat deflection rating of 209 degrees Celsius under load. So the key thing to remember when you think about heat deflection is that, again, load and the time of exposure are the critical points. Most parts will perform well at high temperature for a short period. But your true heat deflection is going to be under load for a long period of time. That's typically where HDT is going to come into play. Long exposure items would be fixtures in welding fixtures, for instance, fixtures that are going to be exposed to high temperature environments with forces applied. So PA6MF is generally known as an automotive grade material. The other part of that is that PA6, when you print it, is completely airtight and watertight. So it's not only is it impervious to heat, it's great for underhood automotive applications such as a brake fluid reservoir, for instance. So it needs to hold liquid, it needs to handle the heat, and it needs to be of a certain strength. And PA6 mineral filled is a great material for that. One thing you're going to find universally with filled materials is they have pretty low elongation to break, which stands to reason as stiffness goes up, flexibility goes down. So these parts are going to be much more rigid by the nature of the reinforcement. PA11CF is a very interesting material being based on PA11, which is widely used for its mechanical toughness and ductility. in the market. When you reinforce PA11 with CF, it does become much more rigid, but still has outstanding elongation to break compared to some other materials like a PA6 or a PA12 glass filled. That 11% can get you into applications where potentially, while you needed the strength, it wasn't quite ductile enough or tough enough to fit the bill. So PA11 CF can be used in cases where the mineral filled PA6 or the glass bead PA12 may be just a little too rigid and too brittle from reinforcement. So PA11 is a very interesting material. We have customers using it in the motorsports area where they need very rigid, lightweight parts. Aftermarket automotive applications, we've done had customers buy machines to run this material specifically for doing custom LED enclosures for motorcycles and various automotive applications. So it's an excellent material. It has an incredible combination of elongation to break and heat deflection, and it runs well on all of our QLS platforms that we have available. Lastly is PA12 GB. While we don't offer a PA12 glass fill material directly, because our systems are open platform, we have many customers who are running PA12 glass fill from other providers. And we've also have customers running recycled PA12 glass bead reinforced materials from HP. So the nice thing there is if you have HP and you're relying on PA12 glass bead in high volumes, you are likely generating a significant amount of waste product, which can be printed directly on our QLS machines. What you're looking at there on the right is a completely recycled part from waste powder, HP multi-jet fusion PA12 glass bead. So the interesting thing here is if you look across these mechanical properties, you can kind of make a selection based on what you need the material to do, whether it's going to be the maximum possible strength, the maximum stiffness, or something that's going to give a little bit more and maybe provide a different heat deflection temperature number. So the good news is in the world of selective laser sintering, you have a wide range of filled materials that can solve a lot of applications. There are also filled materials out there like with aluminum and other products. Those products also work very well on our machines. There, if we go into the area of food grade materials, there are materials which are not necessarily reinforced, but filled with metal powders for the detectability of them. So I would keep in mind that filled materials are typically filling a specific need that you may have or you may not have access to on your filament-based printers or other technologies, especially photo curing technologies. Again, open platform material systems, that's a big benefit that we offer, and we have multiple machines to do that. On the smaller side, the fast cycle, high power SLS, the QLS260, which we announced last week at Formnext, is a very compelling printer based on its price and also based on it has a excellent build volume and fast cycle sintering. And what I mean by fast cycle sintering is that when you fill up the build, even running reinforced materials or even all the way down to elastomers, you can print a full build in about 22 hours, and then we only require 2 hours of in-machine cooling, so you can start the build again the next day at the very next time. This fast cycle ensures you're going to get the maximum amount of parts out of your machine across time, and it's going to work very much in phase with your staff. So if your staff comes in and changes over the machine at 9 a.m. every day, you're going to be doing that every day repeatedly, and you're not going to have a situation where your machine stops working at 6 p.m. and just sits overnight with no productivity. So that's key. The other thing we've added to this platform, migrating from the 230 and the 236, is built-in nitrogen generation. The big benefit here is that you don't have to go to a third party and buy a nitrogen membrane system, which takes up floor space and adds cost. It's built in. So all you need to do is plug in the electricity and compressed air from your shop system. It has a 60 watt CO2 laser. CO2 lasers are well known as being the most versatile technology in the market of QLS or selective laser sintering, by allowing you to work on multiple wavelengths that are not restricted by diode style or fiber lasers. So we can do white powders, black powders, filled materials, elastomers, very soft TPUs. All of these materials are available and capable of being printed at a very high level, high resolution with this machine. Another nice benefit of selecting the QLS260 for reinforced parts is that we have the ability to do material changes in about 1 hour in machine. Big advantage there is you're not buying a machine, you're locking yourself into running one material that can't change or takes all day to change material. So if you want to experiment with reinforced materials, or you have an application for them and you have one of our printers, you can run, you can buy a small amount of material, run those parts in a day, and then switch back over to a more used material that you may have, like a base PA12 or PA11 or TPU. So that's a big advantage. Also, if you're operating a service bureau or have a single MJF, being an open platform system will be a breath of fresh air to you, because it will allow you to recycle your waste powder and get all of the money that you pay for in parts. So we currently have about 20 plus materials that we either are selling or our customers have qualified with our assistance and run on their machine. So the good news is here, if we're not offering a material but you have an interest in it, we're happy to take a look at the TDS for the material and help you with start parameters. Again, our machines are completely open and they will basically allow you to quickly qualify materials as you go. The other big benefit of the QLS technology, while it's not reinforced material, we do offer the ability to run metals on these machines. So if you get to a point where you need additional mechanical properties beyond what the great reinforced materials can offer, we have the ability on the same platform to run titanium 6-4, 316 stainless, 17-4 stainless, and M2 tool steel on the same platforms. So it really gives you an unbeatable platform to go from very soft TPUs up through the reinforced polyamides we've been discussing today, also all the way through the metals technology. So let's look at our QLS 820. This is, we carry over some of the traits of the QLS 260 being an open platform system, but this is a much larger build platform with four lasers. So this is the fastest selective laser sintering technology in the world. We have the ability to run three complete builds in a single day, and that's not at very low density. We're talking about 20% print density, which is exceedingly high. We can run this machine complete lights out and use AGV vehicles to change carts if that's what you would like to do. It is also open platform. You're able to bring your own materials to the party if you have something that you want to run that we aren't currently offering for sale. So again, at Nexa3D, we offer what we believe is the future of this business, which are open platform, selective laser sintering machines that can run at high speed with fast cycle, that can run all of the materials you wish from very soft TPUs through reinforced materials and metals. Okay. So I think we could open it up for questions. I'm happy to answer any questions that you may have.
Okay, I'll take over from here. So we have a few questions to start off with. Is the surface quality of QLS carbon fiber parts good enough to use after printing, or does it require further post-processing?
Yeah, I would say that the quality is very good. I mean, with all QLS, you're going to do some post-processing. Typically, the parts are depowdered and then bead blasted to get the powder off of the part. At that point, the parts are ready for use in most cases. I know for sure the PA11CF parts look amazing. We've had several of those in our booth, and people regard the fine detail and the surface finish to be superior than some unfilled materials. So it really depends on how far and what you want to do with the part, but these parts can be used as finished products right out of the machine. The nice thing here is also the PA11CF and the PA6 mineral filled reinforced materials are jet black right out of the machine. They don't require any dyeing that you might be encouraged to do with other technologies which don't use lasers.
All right, next up, and a good follow-up to that last question, can QLS-CF parts be vapor smoothed?
I believe they can be vapor smooth. They're just a PA11 base material. So you would want to check with AMT for the right recipe, but I don't see any reason why they can't be vapor smooth.
Okay, next up we have, how do QLS-CF parts compare to FDM-CF parts?
Yeah, that's a great question. So we actually exceed the mechanical properties of filament-based carbon fiber reinforced by a significant amount. If you look at a Mark Forged Onyx material versus PA11-CF and compare the data sheets, you will see significant enhancements. Specifically around that elongation number of 11% would be impossible to achieve with filament-based printers. And there are some other heat deflection advantages as well. The big difference here, we're talking about, you know, slight improvement in mechanical properties. That's nice, but the big advantage is in productivity. When you switch over to a QLS or selective laser sintering with a reinforced material, even our small printer, the QLS-260, could easily replace about 20 Mark Forge machines running simultaneously in terms of its throughput. It's also going to be much more cost effective on a serial production or even medium kind of production run on a cost perspective because of the lack of supports and being able to recycle the powder as we print.
To add to John's response to that, I would say that, you know, Mark Forged continuous fiber is notoriously difficult to print in a Z direction, and you're going to get much more isotropic parts out of our solution than you're going to get out of a Mark Forged, or I'm not specifically trying to call them out, but pretty much any FDM technology. So, yeah, I would definitely second what John said.
All right, and unless we have any more coming in, we have one left. What are the production times of QLS versus FFF?
Yeah, so, you know, with the 820, we can turn over our 350 by 350 by 400 build volume nested at 20% density 2 to 3 times a day. So it's a dramatic increase over filament-based printing. I think you can use these kind of graphic at the bottom of my slide here showing 3 complete nested builds at 20% density a day. You know, the number of FDM or FFF printers that would be required to do that number of parts would be huge. So it's a much, much quicker. It's about 20 times for a rough estimate, the speed of filament-based printing.
Oh. I would also add, and John used the term nesting. Nesting isn't something you're going to be able to do on an FDM printer. So you're only going to be able to print one layer of parts on an FDM printer, whereas you can print as many layers of parts as you can fit in the entire Z direction. So it's going to be a multitude more.
All right. So that was our last question. Just to wrap up, this was our 4th of 4 webinars around carbon fiber printing. Thank you, Greg and John, and I hope everyone has a great day.